Hi, my name is Stephen Gregg. I'm with Saved by Truth Ministry. And the Lord wanted me to share this message with you because this is so important. The great deception, the one that's mentioned in the Bible in 2 Thessalonians 2, has now been revealed. I'm going to reveal today what the true deception is so you can avoid being deceived by Satan and his ministers and his demons around the world that are deceiving the people so they will not make it to the kingdom of God. It's going to be a very quick, brief message. And this message is going to really show you exactly what the deception is, so you can actually avoid taking it and you can actually make it to the kingdom of God. So I'm going to go through a few scriptures. I'm going to show you a slideshow and we're going to go right through it. It's very, very simple for you to understand. So this is some videos that I recommend you to take a screenshot here. Take this screenshot and actually go to these websites. One of them is savebytruth.com. That's our website. bitshoot.com/SavedByTruthMinistry is where our videos are, and you can also watch the videos there with the links. This is very important for you to learn this message. This is the great deception. I'm going to keep it really simple. The great deception has to do with three things. Number one, being baptized in water for the forgiveness of your sins. Number two, the Ten Commandments. And three, keeping the Sabbath day holy, which is the true Sabbath day. And today, what I'm going to do is show you exactly what that is, exactly how it works, so you'll know, and there'll be no doubt. You'll understand exactly what the great deception is. See, people right now are waiting for this big deception from Satan to come down from the sky and do all this crazy stuff. No, the deception is with the disciples, is with the believers, is with people that love the Lord, that say they love the Lord. That's what the deception is. And the deception has to do with scripture. They're deceived because they don't love the truth. And that's what we're going to read. So we're going to read the scriptures right now. This is 2 Thessalonians 2. I'm going to read the actual scripture so you can see what it says. Look what it says. It says the coming of the lawlessness. This is the man of lawlessness, which has been revealed in our videos. We've already revealed who he is. Look what it says. It says, verse 2. This is 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 1. Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him. That's the rapture. That's the time frame he's talking about. It says, we ask you, brothers and sisters, do not become easily unsettled and alarmed by the teaching allegedly from us, whether by prophecy or word or by mouth and by letter, asserting that the day of the Lord has already come. See, this is the deception. See, it's about the teaching that's from the people in the scriptures. So back in the day, the people in the scriptures were teaching the truth of the Bible. And that's what I'm teaching right now is going to be the truth of what the scripture says. But see, there's a lot of people that's going to believe a lot of deceptive teachings. Let's keep reading. Verse 3, don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. The first thing is the man has been revealed. If you go to our website, Saved by Truth, you'll see who that is. We've already done a whole video on the man of lawlessness. But the big thing I want you to see here, look what it says. It says a rebellion has to occur. Now, the rebellion is of the believers. It's not non-believers. Non-believers are already rebellion. It's talking about the believers. And you're going to see, based on this video, you're going to watch the comments on this video. When I start talking about baptism, when I start talking about the commandments, when I start talking about the Sabbath day, you watch the comments in this video, people are going to be rebelling. They're going to say baptism isn't for forgiveness of sin. All you need to do is say a sinner's prayer. You don't need to obey the commandments. You don't need to obey the Sabbath day. Jesus is the Sabbath day. They're going to come with all this deception because that is the rebellion. Their rebellion against the truth. Let's keep reading. Look what it says. He will exalt himself above everything that is called God or is worship, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Don't you remember that when I used to tell you these things, and now you know what is holding him back so that he may be revealed at the proper time. This is the proper time. The secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who holds him back will continue to do so until he is taken out of the way. Then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the splendor of his coming. So we know he's talking about the coming of the Lord. Look what it says next. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance to how Satan works. Satan is the master of deception. So that's how he works, is through deception. He will use all kinds of sorts of display of powers and signs and wonders to serve the lie. See, it's a lie. It's the opposite of truth. And ways that wickedness deceives those who are perishing. Now let's listen to the reason why they say they perish. Verse 10, they perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. So the problem is that the disciples and the believers and the Christians and the pastors, it's because the reason why there's such a narrow road and most people won't find it is because they refuse to love the truth. They've been taught a deception. And I'm going to tell you what the deception is. It has to do with three things. It has to do with baptism in water for the forgiveness of your sins as an adult in Jesus' name. It has to do with keeping the Ten Commandments holy, and it has to do with the Sabbath day. You're going to see that in a minute. I'm going to prove it beyond a shadow of a doubt. It says, verse 11, for this reason, so for the reason that they love the deception, it says God sends them a powerful delusion so they'll believe the lie. And you're going to see in the comments below, you're going to see people arguing the scripture. They're going to be mad at me. They're going to be arguing with what I'm sharing. They're going to say it's not true. That's because that is the great delusion. It says so they will be condemned to not have believed the truth and to have delighted in wickedness. So these people are, what's going to happen is these people are going to be delighted in wickedness, and that's exactly what's happening. So let me go through some more things here I want to show you now. Now I'm going to prove it to you beyond a shadow of a doubt. 99% of all believers and Christians and pastors and people around the world, especially in the U.S., are going to go through the Great Tribulation. They're going to go through the hour of trial. They're going to be left behind because they're going to believe the lie. Let's look at the lie. Look what it says. Let's read the scriptures. Acts 2:38-39. I'm going to pull it up here on the scriptures. I'm going to pull it up so you can read it in the Bible. Look what it says. Acts 2:36. It says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said, Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Now, if this was today, if this was a church today, what would they say? They would say, oh, just say the sinner's prayer and you'll be saved. Oh, just accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Or just confess with your mouth and believe your heart. Or you're saved by grace. Or you're saved by faith alone. Or you're saved by works. Or you're saved by something. They'll come up with all these different ways to say, being saved. But let's see what Peter said. Peter said, Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. See, people today have been taught the lie. They've been saying that they said a sinner's prayer, they got the Holy Spirit, and then they go get baptized later as an outward sign of an inward grace. But there's not a single scripture in the Bible that teaches that. Peter said, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, not because you've already had your sins forgiven. That's the deception. That's the lie. See, Satan wants all men to be not saved. He wants all men to accept the lie. So that is it. Look what it says. It's a promise. Verse 39. He says, the promise is for you, and it's for your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord God will call, which is all of us that are watching this message. He says, with many other words, he warns them and pleading with them, save yourself from this corrupt generation. So this has to do with salvation. Baptism has to do with salvation. And look what it says in verse 41. Those who accepted this message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Here's the great deception. See, people think that they have to accept Jesus as the Lord and Savior. No, they can accept Jesus all they want, but if they're not baptized in water for the forgiveness of their sins, they do not have their sins forgiven. They are still under the yoke of slavery, under sin. So that's what people don't understand. That is a part of the great deception. I'm going to show you here. We're going to look at some things. I'm going to give you some scriptures so you can write down. Write down all of these scriptures. Don't just take my word for it. Read the scriptures, watch the video, and listen to this information. Matthew 3:13-17. It's when Jesus was baptized. It's to fulfill all righteousness. John 3:3-7. It's to be born again. To participate in the death, burial, and resurrection is Romans 6:1-4. It's when you're participating in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Acts 2:36-41. It's to receive forgiveness of sin. Acts 2:36-41 is to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is free. It says 1 Corinthians 12-13. It says it's to be added to the body of Christ. If you read Galatians 3:26-41, is to be considered Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. See, there is no more Jew or Greek or slave or free or male or female anymore. Read Galatians 3. We're all one in Christ Jesus. Those who are baptized are one in Christ Jesus. Then it says in Mark 6:15-16, it says, and 1 Peter 3:18-20, it says it's to be saved and to enter the kingdom of heaven. John 3:1-7, it says no one will enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and spirit. The only time biblically where water and spirit come together, it is at baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. So it's so important that you understand this is the first great deception that most believers around the world are believing. That is the great deception. And you're going to watch. Watch what's going to happen. watch this video. You watch below, look at the comments below, and you're going to see people arguing, people mad at me, people cursing at me, people saying that it's not true, people saying I was saved by a sinner's prayer, I was saved by faith, I was saved by grace, I went to a harvest crusade, I was saved. They're going to say all kinds of things, but they're not going to say that they were baptized in water on a certain date. I'll tell you right now, I was born again October 17th, 1999, because that was the day I was born again. If you ask anybody watching this video, you know the date you were born. Well, wasn't the date you were born again? Shouldn't that be even a more important date? How come you don't know the day? The reason why you don't know the day most of the time is because you weren't born again. That's the reason why. It's because you may have accepted Jesus. You might have repented from your sins. You might have been walking with the Lord and doing the best you could. But if you haven't been born again, in other words, baptized in water for the forgiveness of your sins, you are still in your sins. So let's go ahead and look at some more scripture on this. This is very important. The next deception, the second biggest one, is the Ten Commandments. People are told that you don't have to keep the Ten Commandments, that they were nailed to a cross. That is false doctrine. See, the Bible, all scripture is God-breathed. From Genesis to Revelation, the book, the entire Bible is God's commandments. Look what it says here. Exodus 20, verse 1 through 7. It says, these are the Ten Commandments that God gave us. And it says, if you read Exodus 20, verse 1, it says, I am the Lord your God. See, the Lord is Jesus. Jesus was there at the very beginning. He's the one who gave the Ten Commandments to Moses. So if you look in Matthew 19, verse 16 and 17, we're going to look at that scripture right now, because I'd like for you to look at the scripture in the Bible. Look at Matthew 19. Look at what he says. Now, if this is not true, you got to understand, then Jesus wouldn't say this. This is Jesus saying this out of his own mouth. It says, a rich young man came to Jesus and asked, Teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life? What's the question the man asked him? He asked him, what do I need to do to get eternal life? In other words, to be saved, because no one gets eternal life if they're not saved. So that's obviously a salvation question. So he came to Jesus and asked, what good thing must I do to get eternal life? And Jesus answered, why do you ask me what is good? Jesus replied, there is only one who is good. If you want to enter eternal life, keep the commandments. Now, here's why people get deceived. They say, well, yeah, but what commandments is he talking about? Well, the guy asked the same question. He said, well, which ones? And he started rattling off. You shall not murder. That's one of the Ten Commandments. You shall not commit adultery. One of the Ten Commandments. You shall not steal. He didn't have to go through all 10 of them, because the guy stopped him and said, wait a minute, I keep all these. Which one do I lack? And that's the question you should be asking yourself. Which one of the Ten Commandments do I lack? Not that I don't have to keep them. Which one am I lacking? And I'm going to show you which one most people are lacking. Because any good-hearted Christian doesn't murder, is not committing adultery, is not stealing, is not committing false testimony, is honoring their father and mother. It's not that one. So which one do you lack? And that's what we're going to show you right now. Because that's the one 99% of the population on earth are lacking. And we're going to talk about that in a second. But it's so important to understand, if you want to enter eternal life, if you want to make it to the kingdom of heaven, you've got to keep the commandments. And you got to understand, that is one of the great deceptions in the world right now. So we're going to look at some more things here, so you can see it. And I'm going to give you the scripture. I'm going fast because I want you to dissect this information. Jesus says in John 14, 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Let me ask you this. Will you make it to the kingdom if you don't love Jesus? No. Well, he says, if you love me, keep my commandments. The law of opposites says, if you don't love me, don't keep my commandments. Look what it says in Revelation 22, verse 14. Blessed are those who do his commandments. They have the right to enter, have the right to the tree of life, and may enter through the gates into the city. So who's going to enter into the gates? Those who do the Ten Commandments, not those who believe in them, those who know them, and those who nailed them to a cross. They're going to be left behind. So it's so important that this is the great deception that most believers have been deceived on. It's so important that you understand this. Look what it says, John 2, verse 3 through 6. It says, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Remember, the great deception has to do with truth. This is the truth. The truth is that we have to keep the commandments, that we have to be baptized in water for the forgiveness of your sin. But watch the comments, watch below. People are going to be mad at me saying, oh, you don't need to keep the commandments. Jesus was the fulfillment of the commandments. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you need to keep the commandments. And you got to remember, when Jesus was walking around the earth, the only thing they had was the Old Testament. There was no New Testament because they were living the New Testament. So it wasn't written yet. So the commandments he was talking about is the Ten Commandments. It says, verse 5, it says, if we obey his word, the love of God is truly made complete in us. This is how we know we're in him. We claim, whoever claims to live in him must do as Jesus did, must live as Jesus did. So did Jesus keep the Ten Commandments? Yes, and we must keep the Ten Commandments. Was Jesus baptized in water for the forgiveness of his sins and then received the gift of the Holy Spirit? Even though he didn't have sins, he did it to fulfill all righteousness. In other words, to show us what we're going to have to do in the future. Now, I know what people are going to say real quick. People are going to say, yeah, but this is nailed to a cross, right? No, where does it say it's nailed to a cross? That's man-made teaching. That's not in the Bible. So we're going to go through deception number three. Deception number three is this is one of the biggest deceptions out there, that people say that you don't have to keep the Sabbath day holy, the fourth commandment. Now let's read what it says. This is Hebrews 4, verse 9. You can start reading the whole thing. Matter of fact, let me go to pull up the scripture. Let me show it to you in the Bible. This is Hebrews 4, starting in verse 8. It says, for if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken later about another day. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest, rests from their work just as God did from his. What day did he rest from his work? The seventh day. He didn't rest on Saturday. He didn't rest on Friday. He didn't rest on Sunday. Here's why. Because there is no Friday, Saturday, Sunday anywhere in Scripture. Matter of fact, the Pope Gregorian calendar wasn't even invented yet. Pope Gregory, who's the Pope Gregorian calendar, who it's written after, was never even born yet. So it couldn't have been on Friday or Saturday or Sunday. It was when they looked up at the sky and they saw the new moon, which you're going to see in a minute. It says, therefore, make every effort to enter that rest so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. See, the Israelites didn't go into the promised land. Why? Because they broke the commandments. Well, guess what's going to happen to the Christians? The pastors, the believers, the baptized disciples that nailed the Ten Commandments to the cross. Guess what's going to happen to them? The exact same thing. When Jesus comes to take his 144,000, the narrow road, the people that are his bride of Christ, the people that are actually obeying him, which is the Church of Philadelphia, when the Lord comes to take them to the kingdom of heaven, guess what's going to happen to everyone else? They're going to be left behind, and you're going to have to listen to the angels speak the same exact message. Read Revelation 14, verses 6 through 14. It's the exact same message. It's called the eternal gospel. So it's so important that you understand this. Let me show you actually how the Ten Commandments actually works. This is what God revealed to me years ago. I'm going to show it to you so you can have it. Here's how the true Sabbath works. And look what it says, Isaiah 66. Isaiah 66 is the end of the book of Revelation. Look what it says. As the new heaven and a new earth I make before me, declares the Lord, so will your name and descendants endure. From one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another, all mankind will come and bow down before me, declares the Lord. Well, I thought the Sabbath was done away with. I thought it was nailed to a cross. Well, in the days when there's a new heaven, new earth, we're going to be honoring the Sabbath. So do you think we need to honor it now? The answer is yes, except for the people that call themselves Jews, who are actually the children of the Canaanite, and the people that call themselves disciples, who are actually Christians and the children of the Vatican, most of them. They don't teach this. They don't teach the true Sabbath day. And what God has revealed to me is what to teach and how it actually works. I'm going to show it to you right now. So here's the only scripture in the Bible that actually shows how God starts his month. See, it's not based on the week. It's based on the month. And let me show it to you. This is 1 Samuel 20, verse 5. So David said, look, tomorrow is the new moon feast, and I'm supposed to dine with the king. But let me go and hide in the field until the evening of the day after tomorrow. You got to read the whole story to understand what was happening. But Saul was going to try to kill David. But I'm not going to go through the whole story. But what did he look at? He said, look. What was he looking at? His watch? Was he looking at his iPhone? What was he looking at? A calendar? No, he was looking up at the new moon. That's how he knew that the next day was going to be the new moon feast. Look what it says, verse 24. So David hid in the field, and when the new moon feast came, the king sat down to eat. And he said, customary place by the wall opposite Jonathan, and Abner sat next to Saul. David's place was empty again. Saul said nothing that day, for he thought something must have happened to David to make him ceremonially unclean. But the next day, so surely he is unclean. Verse 27, but the next day, the second day of the month, David's place was empty again. So you can see that's the second day of the month. So you spot the new moon. That's the next day is the first day. The day after that is the second day. Let me break this down. The Lord has revealed and restored his calendar and has restored it all over the world. This may be the first time you're hearing this message. So in other words, the Sabbath is not on Friday night to Saturday night. It's not a Sabbath night. It's called a Sabbath day. And the day begins in the morning and it ends at evening. It's during the work hours. Because remember, they had to stop from their work to go honor the Lord. They didn't stop from sleeping. They didn't stop from resting. They stopped from working. And it's a Sabbath day. It's not a Sabbath day and night. It's a 12-hour period from morning to evening. Look what it says. Here's how it works. You spot the new moon at night. And then the next day in the morning is the first day of the month. It's called the new moon celebration. We honor it. It means new month. In Hebrew, moon means month. So it's the new month celebration. And then we just count 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. On the seventh day, it's always a half a moon. It was the fourth, it's the seventh day. So this Tuesday that just ended was the third Sabbath of the eighth month on God's calendar. It happened to land on Tuesday this month because every month it changes based on the Gregorian calendar because they put that calendar in the way to distract us so you won't know the true Sabbath day. Look what it says, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. The 14th day is always a full moon. Go back and look. Last Tuesday was a full moon. How do we know? Because it's always the 14th day of the month. Then 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, the 21st day, which was this Tuesday just went by, it was a half a moon the other side, and then 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, and this moon is going to be a sliver or a dark moon, and then we have to go back out and look for the new moon again. That's how God did it. God wants us to rely on his calendar. He doesn't want us to rely on man's calendar. He doesn't want us to rely on just going day by day, every single day, just relying on nothing. He wants us to rely on him, and he's bringing back his Sabbath day. Myself and our ministry around the world have been honoring this now for 12 years, and now pastors all around the world are finally taking their entire congregations off Sunday keeping by faith, keep taking them off Saturday keeping by faith, and starting to honor the true Sabbath day. Why do you think it's such a narrow road and most people won't find it? Why? Because the three biggest things that people are going to argue about, I guarantee you, people are arguing right now in this message. I bet you below me, people are cussing me out. They're mad at me right now because I'm telling them that they're not saved. If you haven't been baptized in water for the forgiveness of your sins, you don't have your sins forgiven. You're lost. You're still in your sins right now. You do not have the Holy Spirit. If you have said a sinner's prayer, you don't have the Holy Spirit right now. And I'm going to say it boldly, and I just showed it in Scripture. So I'm going to tell you right now, if you haven't been baptized as an adult in water for the forgiveness of your sins, you're still in your sins. You're not part of the body of Christ. You do not have your sins forgiven. You're not saved, and you will never make it to the kingdom of God unless you repent and be baptized as an adult, as a disciple of Jesus. Number two, the Bible says that you need to keep the commandments of God. If you have not kept the commandments of God and you do choose not to keep the commandments of God, I'm going to tell you now, you will not make it to the kingdom of God. You will be left behind and go through the hour of trial. And then the angels will need to come and teach you this message. That's what's happening right now. And then the last one is the Sabbath day. This is the separator between God and his people. The Bible says, if you read Exodus 31, verse 12 through 18, God says he gave the Sabbath as a sign between God and his people. See, if you take the Ten Commandments, you break all 10 of them down. You can take any good-hearted Christian, any good-hearted disciple, any good-hearted person who loves Jesus, and 9 of them, they'll obey. But guess which is the one that separates the true disciples? The ones that know they're honoring the true Lord, the one that made the heaven and earth, the one that separated the Red Sea, the one who led them out of Egypt, the one that made the heaven and earth and everything. How do you know you're honoring the real Lord? Because you're going to honor his true Sabbath day. See, the Church of Philadelphia follows the Lord wherever he goes. If it's on a Tuesday, then that's the day we honor the Sabbath day. Our job doesn't get in the way. If it happens to be on a Thursday, then that's the day we honor the Lord. See, the truth of the true church, the true Church of Philadelphia, the true disciples honor the Lord wherever he goes. And so the first fruit, the 144,000, will be going to the kingdom of God very, very soon. I lead Saved by Truth Ministry. You can go to my website. I don't hide from anyone. If you have a question about something I shared, message me on Facebook. You can come to my website. You can call me direct. I don't hide from anyone. I don't care who you are. If you have questions about the scriptures, the Bible will answer the question, and I'll be more than happy to share this information with you. But I'm going to tell you right now, this is the great deception. This is what God wants people to know. So what we're doing right now, we're calling spiritual leaders. We're calling baptized disciples. We're calling Christians to come back to the truth so you can be saved. You got to understand, I'm not saying this message to you to be mad at you. I'm not saying it because I don't want you to be saved. I'm not saying it to you because I don't like you. I'm saying it because I love you. I'm saying it because the Lord loves you. I'm saying it because God wants you to be saved. See, there's a deception. That's a great deception. And if you continue to want to believe the lie, God is going to let you. And then you'll go through the hour of trial. But now you know the truth. If you've watched this video, if you've listened to this message, you now know that baptism in water for forgiveness of sin is how you get your sins forgiven, and that's how you're saved. Second thing is, you know, you need to keep the Ten Commandments holy, because if you don't keep the Ten Commandments holy, you'll never make it to eternal life. And three, you now know how to get to the true Sabbath day. If you choose to keep keeping Sunday holy and keep keeping Friday night to Saturday holy, that's your choice. You have free reign. God gives us free will. But I'm going to tell you, don't expect to make it to the kingdom of God when Jesus comes and changes his people at the twinkle of an eye, the last trumpet. When we go to kingdom of God, you will be left behind. So I'm hoping that you'll take this message to heart. I'm hoping that you'll humble yourself. I'm hoping that you take this message, you pray about it, you look at the scriptures, you dive in, you get mad, you argue about it, and then you share this message with every friend and family that you have so that people can make it to the kingdom of God. I love you. This is Stephen Payne Gregg, the leader of the Church of Philadelphia. I hope you make it. Have a blessed day.